In October of 2014, Suki Kim published an astonishing book called Without You, There Is No Us, chronicling the experiences of her six-month stay in North Korea. Upon publication, the book received much attention and praise from critics. In January of 2015, the book was released in Korea as well. The book is an honest record of the 6 months that Suki Kim spent teaching English to the sons of the highest-ranking officials in North Korea. After emigrating to the U.S. with her parents in middle school, Suki Kim went on to study English literature at Columbia University and Korean literature at the School of Oriental and African Studies in London. In 2003, Suki Kim gained the attention of literary circles with the publication of her first novel, The Interpreter. After visiting North Korea for the first time in 2002, Suki Kim once again entered North Korea as an undercover journalist in July of 2011. This week on Heart to Heart, we talk with the author Suki Kim, who, with honesty and courage, shares her personal experience of North Korea. Pleasure to have you on Heart to Heart. Thank you for joining us. And I know you're feeling under the weather, so thank you even more for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
So how long has it been since your last visit here to Korea?
I guess about a year and a half, but I was on this show before.
You were?
years ago. I believe maybe 2006 with The Interpreter, my first novel.
Okay. So lots of changes in Korea and also the show, right? New host.
Yes. Yes, new host.
Right. But it's great to have you on the show. So let's talk about the book, Without You, There Is No Us, published in October 2014, but already in its sixth publication, printing. So it's released not only in Korea, but also UK, and Poland, some other countries around the world. Did you expect this kind of explosive reaction to your book?
I guess as a writer, you don't have expectations. You're just trying so hard to finish the book and get it out. The one thing I was really, felt satisfied was that I had a team. We did really spend about a year shaping the book. And people asked me, because the book ends when Kim Jong-il dies in 2011, and there's the writing time, but the editing time took a long time to perfect it as much as I could. Absolutely perfect it.
It also seemed like the publication came at an opportune time. You know, there was heightened interest in North Korea, what with the Sony hacking, the interview coming out. It just seemed to sort of coincide at a weird point when there was heightened interest in North Korea.
After the book came out, I guess after October, when the Sony thing happened at the end of November into December, there was definitely, you know, it's an unfortunate incident. And a bizarre one, too, but definitely I think the mainstream American public became interested in the mystery of North Korea.
There was the interview, of course, and it shows, it satirizes many aspects of North Korean life, including the assassination of Kim Jong-un. And then your book, which is, paints a vastly different picture of North Korea. What was the reaction like? Were people able to take it seriously? I mean, what was how were people reacting?
To the book?
Yeah, to the book.
I think interview is a good, in a way, a contrast, because it's almost the opposite. It's a cartoon, apart from the fact it's a comedy, which is a genre. But, you know, within that comedy, there is a very uncomfortable aspect where the topic is a nation that the UN is, you know, referring to the International Criminal Court as the world's violator of human rights. And as you just pointed out, with her assassination scene is, you know, possibly the most cartoon-esque scenes that I've ever seen of, you know, murdering of another sitting president. But I think it's the cartoon jokes about North Korea that has always bothered me living in the West. You know, I live in New York in the United States, and I guess there are many reasons why I wrote the book, but number one reason was always to humanize North Korea and North Koreans. Because unless we look at them as human beings, like us, there's nobody's gonna do anything to help that situation.
So to get under the propaganda that North Korea so often shows or is willing to show the world, you went undercover as a teacher to teach at the Pyongyang University of Institute and Technology in 2011. I know that you had visited North Korea several times before, five times, I believe, from 2002. But this was the first time that you went undercover to really get at the real North Korea. So let's talk about that, how you came across this sort of opportunity. You had been there before, so they must have known about you, and yet you were able to pass yourself off as a teacher, working for missionaries, no less. So how did that process just go about?
Well, I did begin starting 2002, mm-hmm. when I entered for the 60th birthday celebration of Kim Jong-il. Right. I wrote a very long feature essay about the experience. And so that was my first understanding of the limited access mm-hmm. that you have if you want to write about it. And also how devastated it is there. It was my first witnessing what it's like inside. And then I went to cover the New York Philharmonic in Pyongyang for Harper's Magazine. And that was sort of a media, you know, a coup in a way. Like, you know, it was sort of, there was nothing anybody could write about. It mm-hmm. was just a concert, really. And packaged as a peace-bringing occasion. I don't know what peace it brought. You know, it was sort of a propaganda. It played straight into the propaganda of Pyongyang, North Korean regime, to mm-hmm. portray themselves as this Gershwin-loving, you know, very civilized society.
Right.
So, you know, that basically did make me think I have to be embedded if I want to write anything that's meaningful other than the North Korean government's propaganda. Mm-hmm. And I have no interest in being North Korean government's publicist. So how will I do this? Be embedded. So that's how I ended up going when I found out about this school. I did get in. For various reasons. Number one reason, you know, people think that North Koreans would just simply Google and then not let you in. Mm-hmm. That does happen, but it's a very compartmentalized society. So the fact that I was a freelance writer who didn't belong with any organization, the only thing that I had that they could name me was the fact that I was a novelist, wrote a book called The Interpreter. Mm-hmm. And Pyongyang University of Science and Technology had already approved me as an English teacher because of my writing background.
Mm-hmm. No teaching experience.
No
right?
teaching experience. Oh, well, I had a teaching experience in the States,
okay.
teaching creative writing. I'd never taught ESL before. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Pyongyang University of Science and Technology had okayed me and was open about the fact that I was a novelist. So the North Korean regime went with that. But, you know, the fact that it's a compartmentalized society, the people who approved PUST from North Korean side is an education ministry. Mm-hmm. And that education ministry said, okay. You know, it's not like this organization is gonna check with every other organization.
Okay.
It will if I were a reporter for the New York Times or something. Mm. I've written for the Times, but I'm not a journalist representing mm-hmm. the Times. So I think there is a bit of a disconnect between what we perceive North Korea to be. Mm-hmm. So basically they okayed a teacher who was approved by PUST.
Okay. We'll talk more about sort of going undercover in just a moment. But Suki Kim's 2003 novel, The Interpreter, is the story of a 1.5 generation Korean immigrant living in the U.S. And it received much praise from critics, with one saying that her prose was even more beautiful than that of a native English speaker. She's used her writing talent this time to capture her experience of North Korean life in the latest book. We'll find out more after this.
Everything was watched 24/7. Like, I remember thinking at some point, no matter where I was in the campus, somebody saw me from the window. So that small, you know, that you can't see everyone because it's circular. You know, there was this sense you're just never alone. You're never private.
Suki Kim taught English to the elite students of PUST, Pyongyang University of Science and Technology, for 6 months in 2011. The last day of teaching coincided with the death of Kim Jong-il, but she had gone there to fulfill a special purpose. So your admitted entry into North Korea as a teacher, but with the covert intention of almost acting like an undercover journalist. You were there to report on what really went on beyond the facade, underneath that facade. I can't imagine how tense and anxious you felt during the months that you were spending there. You wrote in the book that the students and the teachers were constantly under surveillance and you had minders with you all the time as well. As a foreigner, did you feel that you were under that same sort of surveillance as your North Korean students as well?
In some way, yes. In a way, I thought they were under more surveillance than we were, mm-hmm. because at least the teachers were allowed out with a minder,
right.
Once a week. Often we went this, it's very all organized, you know, it would be like 2 to 4, you know, school bus mm-hmm. out into the same exact path to that grocery store only foreigners use and all come back as a group. Mm-hmm. So that kind of outing or a special trip to show you some famous sites, such as the mountains, Kumgangsan or Myeongsan, or, you know, we saw like the apple farm. Mm-hmm. that the great leader had hailed as one of the country's wonders. So we were seeing things like that. The students were never allowed out. So I think on some level, they were just constantly watched mm-hmm. far more.
In addition to not having the freedom to leave and go and as you please, you always felt that you also have to be careful about what you said, the students too. Did you have some sort of guidance in advance? Did the university or people tell you this is what you can talk about, what you can't talk about, and if you disobeyed that or if you overstepped your boundaries, you would be sent back? Were there some guidelines like that?
Yes, there were a list of full, you know, a very long list of things that we could not do, which was like you don't, you know, say like not South Korea, North Korea. Mm-hmm. You say Joseon, mm-hmm. which is what they call themselves, or you don't say any of the names. You know, Kim Jong Il, Kim Il Sung, Kim Jong Un. Just stay away from it. And any images, you don't point. You know, they all wear these badges of the great leader. Mm-hmm. You never like point at it because it's disrespectful. If it falls, let's say, and you step on it, or yeah. You know, so you don't, you know, those things, you just, images, do not ever do anything that mm-hmm. might show them that you don't, you know, approve or don't wear jeans because Kim Jong-il doesn't like jeans because it's a symbol of America. Mm-hmm. If someone says anything political in tone in any way, you would just say, is that so? And the conversation right there. So there were just endless of these things that you had to keep in your mind. Mm-hmm.
It felt like then you were constantly watching every single word you said, every action you made. Everything was just so controlled and always monitored. And yet in moments in your book, when you, in your interactions with the students, there were moments when it kind of seemed to all melt away and it was just pure joy to interact with these young students. Were those moments quite often, or it seemed in the book they were quite rare actually, but were they more often?
I think they were rare, but they happened with more frequency as time passed, mm-hmm. as we both began to feel more comfortable.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was so tightly controlled, everything, because there were three things. Mm-hmm. There were the dormitory and the cafeteria where we ate 3 meals a day, and then the classrooms. And classrooms were, there were students assigned to report on us and record mm-hmm. the class. But I didn't know who they were because they never told us which one was doing that. So you know that you're not free in the classroom. Meals, you have it with 3 students, and always you knew that they were reporting on each other, so the conversation is being reported. Mm-hmm. And in your dormitory, the minder lives on the ground floor, and students didn't know what the internet was, but the teachers were allowed the internet, but we were told the connection was watched. And the minders who lived on the ground floor, their job 24/7 is to watch us. Mm-hmm. And we knew that we weren't allowed to have a telephone, but there was an inter-campus telephone only among the teachers. So that phone was tapped. So because everything was watched 24/7, And the campus was designed in a way that it's, in the book I describe it as a horseshoe. So basically, and there was this walkway, outdoor walkway that had windows on both sides. So if you have windows on both sides, and it's kind of like this highway kind of a thing that's a walkway that connects from a building to a building, while you're walking there, you can see everybody in the campus because campus is kind of circular. So basically, wherever you are, you're visible to somebody.
So it's not so much that we have like CCTVs everywhere, it's just you're kind of exposed, you felt exposed?
You're exposed in every way because you're watched, but it's also designed that way physically. Mm-hmm. Like I remember thinking at some point, no matter where I was in the campus, somebody saw me from the window. So it's that small, you know, that you can't see everyone because it's circular. So, you know, there was this sense you're just never alone. You're never private.
And you mentioned that your students were never actually allowed to be alone either. They always had a buddy or someone with them as well.
They were never alone with me. No, you can't be one-on-one. They always travel in a pair. Mm-hmm.
But and then yet, despite not ever being alone, you mentioned how alone you felt, how very lonely you felt, because you were separated from these students by ideology, whatever. And at the same time, you could not fit in with the other teachers. You felt separate from them too. Why so?
Well, the teachers pushed this run. They call themselves Christian educators. So, but they're a very famous missionary group within the region. They have the same school in China. I mean, like a parent school. So the teachers were brought there with their very fundamental religious faith. Mm-hmm. So that did separate me from them because I didn't share their faith. So in some way, I didn't share the faith of my students, whose God really was Kim Jong-il, and my fellow teachers, you know, whose God was very clear why they were there.
Mm-hmm. So it's almost like a double betrayal. I mean, to put it bluntly, that you're betraying the teachers and their mission there and then also the students. Did you fear any repercussions after coming out with this novel, and what sort of letters?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's an uncomfortable thing, that whole area of undercover journalism. And I have been attacked on that once the book came out, and I was prepared for that. But the truth is, you have a subject that will not be investigated, the world's most corrupt subject, North Korea. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not my opinion. It's an opinion of the UN as the worst violator, unsurpassed in the contemporary world today, the level of gravity against human rights. So, you know, you have this subject that is the most corrupt subject that will not be investigated, that we have not had any unfiltered portrait coming out of there, because all we have is de facto testimony, often related to a journalist. Or we have, you know, this North Korean government-sponsored press visits, whether it's 3-day, 5-day, 8-day trips, or individuals who are handpicked by the North Korean government, like Dennis Rodman or whoever it is who go in there and see what is allowed to be shown to them. So if we have not had any unfiltered portrait, then is it okay to step back as a person who writes, you know, which is what I do, what I know how to do? So then what is my alternative is to investigate. And I can't do it with North Koreans' permission. So in this case, I went in. I mean, that's where the whole undercover bit comes in, you know, which you have to pretend to be something you're not in order to be accepted by a community, in order to get to the truth. You know, in a perfect ideal world, yes, I would have loved to have gone into North Korea with everybody's permission and come out of there with a actual truth of what's going on in there. This is one case, it's not possible. In the meanwhile, we have a country of 25 million people where millions are dying of persecution and hunger.
You mentioned in the book as well that this is one facet of North Korea, and you've wanted to put a human face on North Korea through your book. Were you also frustrated that you only had a very limited sort of view of North Korea? Obviously, these were the cream of the creme de la creme, the very elite families, sons. Were you very, were you frustrated that you couldn't go beyond, which is maybe another facade of North Korean society? You weren't able to sort of mingle with the regular people or even see other maybe female students. You weren't able to uncover other aspects of North Korea.
I think that's where maybe the depth of writing comes in. Mm-hmm. This is not a book that I just stumbled upon. I was not, you know, a correspondent covering topic and going to write about this. I was born into this topic from a personal angle because I come from separated families. Right. I went in 2002. So from then I had which is a different time historically with North Korea. It comes right after the arduous march, which is the worst famine. So I was able to see what North Korea is like at a different time. I lived in South Korea on a Fulbright in 2009, specifically in order to do defector research. Mm-hmm. I ended up doing a long feature for Harper's Magazine, and I traveled all the surrounding countries from Mongolia, Laos, Thailand, China, obviously, all the border towns to do defector research. And that was in order to understand all different angles that I could possibly get to. Mm-hmm. So by the time I was spending time with this young man, I think that I was coming from a really as much knowledge as I could gather on the topic. Mm-hmm. So that even though I was getting this slice of life, but when you think about it, unless you go backpack through the entire society of any country, any culture, there's no way you can get every aspect. Mm. So I think what I was getting from talking to them, you know, I think through the depth of writing, I was trying to, I guess, make me, I understood as much as I could, and maybe for the readers to understand, what is it like for them for the rest of the world? Mm. These are the elite. Mm-hmm. And I think that question is constantly there. And I think that's sort of the response I've gotten from the readers, that they do constantly wonder. The horror of the book, in a way, I'm not talking about, you know, this is not some dramatic story of like defector escaping a prison camp, mm-hmm. but somehow, from their psychology of how controlled they are, you do constantly wonder what is going on in the rest of the country that is not being shown to you.
Let's talk about that psychology, because I was struck by how you said, you know why you're there. It was for 6 months, which can be considered a short time, also a long time, but it was 6 months and you had a definite purpose to be there. And yet you also felt you were being almost trapped and being sucked into that feeling of helplessness, of wanting just to follow what others do, just getting into that sense of, I don't know, hopelessness. And you mentioned hopelessness and not feeling any freedom and the depression that it overcame you as well, and how easy it was for you to slip into that. Can you describe how it was for you also physically? You mentioned some of the meals that you had and how cold it was, the physical conditions as well. What kind of a toll or what kind of effect it had on you as a person?
You know, first, to be there is really exhausting.
Yes.
I think watching yourself constantly, 24/7.
What you say, what you do.
Everything, everything. I mean, as you're talking to someone, because you're watching yourself because you don't want to get in trouble, but you also don't want to get anyone else in trouble. Mm-hmm. So, as you're talking, you're questioning. You know, you think before you speak always, and then by the time you know the day is over, I come back to the room and I would always go over what I said,
so
and that was also, did I slip up? Did
uh-huh.
I say this? And what was that? You know, and I think that replay button that you mm-hmm. have to do all the time, and also every day being exactly the same because it's mapped out by, you know, the big brother, mm. you know, the government. So it's that repetition of that deja vu feeling is exhausting. And I would physically feel so heavy. Also, you're just not allowed out of the campus. So you're basically circling all the time inside. And that can get incredibly depressing and hard. And plus that, I mean, you know, the food I'm sure it's better than, you know, anything outside of the campus, but generally it was rice and soup, murky soup and some marinated vegetables.
Not
and
a lot of protein or? Uh-huh.
Not much protein, rarely meat. And I think that did also become very draining and the electricity did get cut almost every day as the winter deepened. Mm-hmm. And so when it's really dark, the lack of, you know, heat and the
light,
uh-huh. lack of light, it was just, so I think it was just exhausting.
How did you cope when you got back? I mean, I know it was jarring to be brought from one place where it was so dark and everything just seemed so backward, and to be brought back to New York where everything is lights, and high activity and high energy. Were you physically okay? I mean, to come back into this, your regular world?
You know, it is, it's very jarring. And this abundance, I have to say. I think I remember that December when I came out of there, and you always fly through China, and then you get into Incheon Airport here. And of course, Incheon Airport, you know, one of the best airports in the world. Mm-hmm. And it's just a land of plenty and abundance and carefree. And I think it's just abundance, you know, it's not even anything deeper. It's just you can't believe how much the world has and how much the world doesn't have so close by. It's heartbreaking.
Well, the intelligence that Suki Kim gathered while working undercover as a teacher in North Korea has allowed the world to get a glimpse of how the North Korean elite live, and it has fascinated people all over the world. We'll hear more about her experience right after this. Suki Kim has been invited to give a talk at the Seoul Book and Culture Club, a book club that boasts members from all over the world.
Suki Kim's a very interesting writer. She's written a fantastic novel, and now she's written this fantastic memoir. And in both the novel and the memoir, she talks about some very interesting aspects of the Korean experience and the Korean-American experience, and also the North Korean experience.
It's been 11 years since she's last published a book and held a talk with her readers. The talk covers not only her latest book, Without You, There Is No Us, which received much attention after its publication in 2014, but also her experiences and motivations as a writer. The discussion also touches on Suki Kim's first book, the novel titled The Interpreter. Suki Kim's writing has received praise from American literary critics and has fascinated readers from all over the globe.
I think the most interesting thing to me was the issue that was raised in the questions of the, not just attempting the issue of translating languages, but the issue of translating something in one culture so it's understandable in another culture.
I liked that she was so open as her, as a writer, and got really personal and admitted that she was also just a person trying to connect with other people. So for me, that was the most.
Suki Kim has left a strong impression on her readers. The message she wants to leave with them is a simple one.
I think that, you know, with the recent book especially, the purpose of the writing the whole book was to deliver a humanized, unfiltered portrait of North Korea so that the audience, the readers, can really empathize with and feel what it's like to be there, and also relate to those students in the book so that perhaps they would be motivated to do something to change that world.
By working as an undercover journalist, Suki Kim has opened the world's eyes to the reality of North Korean society. Her courage and passion have moved people from many different cultures. I'm here with the author Suki Kim, who wrote about her experiences as an English teacher at Pyongyang University of Science and Technology. There's a part in your book where a journalist who came to the school said that compared to the school, Guantanamo Bay detention camp seemed like a destination resort, and that was quite shocking. To compare that with a school for the elite, the cream of the cream, did you feel the same way, or was it exaggerating?
I think that that was his opinion.
I
did think, I mean, I called it in the book five-star prison. And, you know, ultimately, I think that's, you know, depending on the journalist's perspective, they have come into the school and covered it. Mm-hmm. BBC just did also recently. And I think that you could get a glimpse of the school looking really nice. It's foreign churches really funded the school and built this school that cost over $35 million. It looks great. The dormitory that I lived in was, you know, kind of better than a lot of other dormitories I've ever been in. So it can look really good also. I think it's just realizing, if you look a little bit deeper, what is really going on in there. Mm-hmm. And number one, if the students are not allowed to leave, I don't know what else that is. Mm-hmm. Because as far as I know, sure, boarding schools, you know, you have like a time when you might be allowed to leave. I mean, this school, these students were not even allowed to keep in touch with home at all, ever. So, and under such a watch every single minute of their time. So I did think it was a prison, you know, because I don't think a school is meant to function that way. A lot of times I felt like they were soldiers rather than college students.
You mentioned that sometimes the students would lie to you and you were able to tell when they were lying to you, but in regards to maybe their freedom or their inability to reach their family members or their friends, did you sometimes think that they could be hiding some truths from you regarding that aspect as well, only allowing you to see a certain aspect?
I mean, there's that. There uh-huh. was that. I mean, some of that was just me learning to decipher when they were lying and when they were not lying. Mm. You know, about calling their mother all the time. At first, they told me they all call their mothers all the time. Soon, I realized that was a lie. Mm. You know, it's not a bad lie. Clearly, they were told to pretend that they were in touch with family.
How did you know they were lying?
Because there was just little incident. For example, you know, one time they were allowed a trip into Pyongyang to a zoo. I don't know why, just one time, the whole time I was there. Mm-hmm. And they said they were kind of so excited, but then, you know, later when they came back from the trip, they said one of the students passed the house, you know, right in front of the house, but you know, the parents, so I was like, so then were the parents on the balcony? Because they mm-hmm. said there's a balcony, so she was looking to see if his mother might be there. But they couldn't, you know, there's no way for them to basically, there wasn't any way for them to tell them that they were going to be in Pyongyang uh-huh. passing the house that day. So this seems like just a very small mm-hmm. Instance, but there were those moments when you pick up that, yeah. okay, obviously they were not allowed to call mm-hmm. or alert anybody. And you know, there was no way. I mean, it's that helplessness. Mm-hmm. You know, they're 20, they're not children. So, and if you are going to be passing your house by chance mm-hmm. after several months of not seeing your parents, but you can't even let them know that. So that's infantilizing mm-hmm. and that they needed a permission. So there were so many of these things, I think, that I knew that they were not allowed to keep in touch with home. But then as time passed, I also learned that sometimes they did. Mm-hmm. And that happened because they were, and before they said they all had telephone, but they gave it up to study better, to study for the great leader.
Voluntarily?
Voluntarily.
Kids voluntarily? I don't believe that. No.
But then it turned out that they didn't have a phone, but sometimes because they were such elite kids mm. that they could borrow the worker's phone mm-hmm. and called home. Mm-hmm. So there were these little things, but it took time for me to understand how it all worked.
Right. You've described the kids as being lovely in some other interviews, and I could sense this bond that you have with them, this affection that you have for them. And for them to be without their parents and to not be in contact with their family and friends must have allowed them to bond with you in a certain way as well. I know that you use false names in the book, but was there maybe one or two boys that you felt a certain closer affinity to? And I don't know if you can
talk
about
them. There were definitely ones that I... you know, I think felt more motherly towards, mm-hmm. you know. Some were just so adorable and make lots of cute jokes all the time. Generally, I love them all. Mm-hmm. They were really, when I say they were lovely, you know, I thought about that a lot. Like, why even more so? And I think it's because their circumstances were hard. And I really, I felt for them. Mm-hmm. They were innocent, far more innocent at that age should be in a way, because they were so sheltered. Mm. And even
not
the
having
lies,
any girlfriends or
not right. pretending also to not have any had any girlfriends, but they're generally innocent. And I think even the lies that they had to tell in order to survive there, mm-hmm. once I understood why they had to lie, I think I blame their system, but I actually, them as individuals, I also felt for them more and empathized more. So I think as time went by, I began to feel that system was so inhumane. But these kids, who I saw, you know, when you spend that much time with someone in a trapped environment, I ate 3 meals a day with them, I played basketball with them, you know, like these were like my kids. So the bond was really like mother to a son a lot of times.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Suki Kim's novel, The Interpreter, was nominated for the Penn Hemingway Prize, and it also won the Penn Beyond Margins Award. We're going to take a look at her novel next, so stay with us. Suki Kim pays a visit to her sister's studio, who's a painter in Korea. There's a reason she's chosen to come here to discuss her first novel, The Interpreter. The novel's cover, which depicts a young girl in a school uniform, was designed by her sister.
While I was writing The Interpreter, actually my sister had a show, so that the brochure of her show was always on my desk. And I always basically was looking at this girl as I was writing The Interpreter. So I think in my mind, I kind of equated the girl with Susie. So when the book was coming out, I immediately thought of the girl as the cover. There was sort of no question on my mind.
The Interpreter is a full-length novel about a young woman who struggles to come to terms with her Korean and American identities. The protagonist, Susie Park, is a Korean interpreter who seeks to uncover the mystery surrounding her parents' murder.
Susie is an interpreter between two languages, but also two cultures. And that process of interpreting between cultures, I wanted to express that how painful that is, and also the sacrifice that you have to make and the loss you have to experience. An interpreter is like a mathematician. She approaches the language as if it were a
The interpreter transforms the story of one woman's immigrant experiences into a universal story of alienation and overcoming hardships.
I think I did, you know, put so much energy into the language. The language, also it's a book about an interpreter, all about language, so it was very important. But the phrase that everyone quotes, that likes a lot, is the beginning, the opening line, which goes, cigarette at 9 a.m. is a sure sign of desperation.
With the acclaim she's received for both her 2003 debut novel and her 2014 memoir of her experiences as an English teacher in North Korea, we look forward to what Suki Kim has in store for the world next. I'm here with the New York Times bestselling author Suki Kim. You've mentioned many times that your purpose in writing this book was to humanize the North Koreans. And at the same time, because of this book, I know that James Kim, who was the president or is still the president of PUST, was not happy with you coming out with the book. I'm not sure how your students, your former students, would react as well. It probably lessens your chances of ever making it back into North Korea as well. Are you happy with that trade-off? Or do you think you've done what you set out to do?
Yeah, there's no way of writing a book like this without upsetting some people. I think the investigation upsets people. For whatever their own agenda is, a lot of people don't want the truth to come out. Some of that are critics who, you know, need to go get back into North Korea. You know, if you criticize North Korea, you actually cannot get back in there. That's the way they control the information also. Mm-hmm. I totally understand with James Kim why he's upset. You know, he works in cooperation with the regime. Mm-hmm. So he's not gonna wanna piss them off. You know, so this book is certainly not going to make them happy, the North Korean government. So I can understand why James Kim is totally unhappy with me. Mm-hmm. As far as students are concerned, I protected them through the book, totally blurred their identity beyond any recognition. And also, they just come across really loyal to the regime, really.
They do.
So what is in the book that could possibly, you know, fault them is, it's you know, they're going to be fine. Mm-hmm. So as far as upsetting a minority of people, for some reason, I think that, you know, people are somehow more concerned with protecting the North Korean regime and those who work in cooperation with the North Korean regime than the truth of the psychology of that world mm-hmm. coming out to the rest of the world, which could possibly do something to bring about a change that could affect 25 million people. For me, that was my priority. So I absolutely did what I had to do and have zero regret.
Okay. So you went to the U.S. when you were 13. You've mentioned before that English is not your native language, and some literary critics have praised your book, The Interpreter, and said that you wrote more beautifully than a native English speaker. Do you still believe that English is not your native language? And if so, how is it possible that you write so beautifully in a second language?
You know, I went to America when mm-hmm. I was 13. I was born and raised here in South Korea, and I did not speak a word of English when I got there. And that whole experience was very traumatic for me mm-hmm. because I didn't choose to go to another country at that age, and I was, you know, I was young. So, and I did always want to be a writer, even as a little girl. So I think that losing home and losing language was not something that I understood. Mm. And it permanently, I think, changed the way I think and feel. So I think becoming a writer, you know, I didn't even write until after college because I didn't know that I could be. You know, English was such a difficult task that I think it was actually took me by surprise when I thought I want to create. You know, speaking is one thing, but creating that mm-hmm. language was not something I thought I would end up doing for my life. But in some way, I think because it's not my first language, it allows some freedom. And maybe a freedom to experiment mm-hmm. and freedom to think in a way that is in both worlds. Mm-hmm. So, for example, in some way, even this book, Without You, There Is No Us, I feel like I'm being an interpreter between North Korea, America, and South Korea, which all three, I feel like I have something right. understanding on some level. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what the first book was. It was literally about an interpreter, mm-hmm. a court interpreter. Mm-hmm. And of course, in that book, the whole book is a mystery about the parents who get murdered brutally one day. And I thought of that as a metaphor for losing home mm. because, you know, my home was taken away from me overnight. So it had to be murder, not just death. So I think that, you know, how did I become a writer? I think sometimes an experience does shape you.
Mm. More practically, though, when did you think, I mean, you always had a lifelong dream of becoming a writer. But you say it was only in college that you really began entertaining the notion that you could become a writer. So what changed? Was there a teacher maybe who influenced you, or was it a subject that a class had helped you? What was the turning point that made you believe that you could?
I think in college, I took, I minored in East Asian literature mm-hmm. at Columbia, where I went. They were really, the East Asian studies was really strong. And when I was taking East Asian literature, and after college, I went to London for a PhD program, which I didn't finish. But there, I really was interested in translating Korean fiction, which is not that known mm-hmm. in the West. Japanese fiction, yes, and Chinese fiction, but right. Korean fiction, nobody knows. So I thought I could do that. But while I was translating, I think I began to kind of think of a better way of writing the sentences. So I think that's where it happened. So I ended up dropping out of the PhD program of the Korean literature and coming back to New York and working, you know, all these magazine mm-hmm. assistant jobs and taking writing classes in the evenings.
Mm-hmm. Did you also end up translating a Korean work into English? Or?
No, I think that I never ended up finishing that translation. And instead, mm-hmm. I ended up writing a novel called The Interpreter.
Sounds amazing. You mentioned some personal connections with North Korea, that your both of your parents came from separated families as well. So I have to ask you what their reaction was to this book, especially not the interpreter, because it, I don't know how they thought about their parents being, it's not all autobiographical, it's just a metaphor, but with this, which is not fiction, what did your parents think about this book?
I think that they understood, you know, they had family members who were lost, taken to North, lost, really disappeared during the war. So it was a topic, you know, but that's not an, I always emphasize, it's not a very rare thing. You know, so many Koreans were affected.
My mother too, of course.
Right, yeah. It's like almost every family. Yeah. It's amazing that, I mean, we're not from, you know, my parents are from South Korea, but yet on both sides, their families went missing during the war. So, you know, when it affects an entire generation like this, which is a generation that has now passing or passed, and their story is not really coming out in a way that is that the world should know. Mm. And I think my parents understood that. My mother was deeply worried when I kept going there, and especially the last time when I was living there, she couldn't even look at me in the face. Because she, you know, I didn't even say goodbye to her because she couldn't look at me. Because it upset her so much.
I would have thought that she would try to stop you from going, no?
I think she knew that I probably couldn't be stopped, but she couldn't bear, I think, the worry. But I think as a work of art, they understood why this book had to be written. Mm-hmm. Because ultimately the book, you know, I think the reception in the States, obviously I think they understood that it was the literary part of the book is very appreciated. And I think it's because ultimately, sure, there's all this information about North Korea, how the elite think, but ultimately the book is about the division. The book is about how when you randomly draw a line and cut up a country and what happens as a result, and you have 60 years, you know, that passed. When I kept saying humanized portrait of North Korea, because I think it's a human story, even the division. So I think like when people talk about the Korean War, they say things like forgotten war, and all these academics write these papers on it. But then all I can think about is my grandmother missing her son until she died. And her just, that mundane, horrible, heartbreak life of waiting for someone to come home for 20, 30 years, your baby, your child. And I think I cannot imagine how many mothers on this, you know, in this country and North Korea just waiting for someone to come home.
It seems like there's a lot of more stories that have to be told. Could you be working on another book about this in the future?
My next book is a novel, and it does touch upon, you know, not North and South, but the theme of, I think, separation, forced separation, that decision, one little decision, you know, and that affects everyone for generations, and that sadness and sorrow and lives that never got lived. You know, I think about when I looked at my grandmother, I thought she must always think about the life she didn't get to live with her son when her son was 27, 37, 47, you know? And I think that's how human mind works when separation happens. Mm. Like I always think, what if I could have been a writer in the Korean language, my home mother tongue? Mm. What if I went to college here? Where would I have gone? And I think this parallel universe that's always in your mind when you've been forced to separate from perhaps your path that you thought you were supposed to be on. So I think the division, I wanted more than anything to sort of tell that story in a human way.
The ironic thing, of course, is that you could take that path now if you wanted. You have the freedom, don't you? You could always write a book in Korean, your language, whereas people north of the border don't have that freedom. And I think you shed some light on that. And it was, yeah, for me personally, it was also quite disturbing. But at the same time, like you say, it was touching to hear about these boys. And we thank you for bringing their stories to us. Thank you, Suki.
Thank you.
And there was our conversation with Suki Kim, author of Without You, There Is No Us. You can watch this interview once again on our homepage, arirangtv.com. So please do so and join us again next time for more Heart to Heart. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.